Assalamu alaikum and welcome to Community Platform. Is extreme and bad religion leading Muslims to abandon religion altogether? Are we representing our faith in the best possible way? Or is there an interpretation that is creating a void, a religious void in our people, especially our young people? Having just recently returned from a Muslim country, I was surprised to find that many young people seem to say no to religion. The word atheist, which I had never heard in that region, seems to be a frequent word that was being used by some young people, and these are educated young people in some very renowned educational institutes. We today will be discussing that topic, that is there bad religion or are we bad at religion? Delighted to have two of my co-hosts, and you know them well. Assalamu alaikum, Adnan.
Wa alaikum assalam.
You okay?
Alhamdulillah.
And of course, Majid. Assalamu alaikum, Majid.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Welcome. Majid, let me start with you. Do we have bad religion? Are we doing bad religion? Is that causing people to become atheists? Are they leaving religion and saying, you know what, religion is so bad, I'd rather not do it? Is that a problem?
No, I don't think there's any such term as bad religion. But we can say that there is outside influences there which are more heavily stronger than religious influences. So even from the religious influences point of view, the exposure to the ideas about our faith are very little and limited to certain aspects of discussion, certain aspects of our life. And lots of discussion missing on other aspects where people, they need answers and they need guidance. So the societal influences, what I was referring to earlier on, they're a lot more stronger. And an absence of Islam in those societal influences simply means that people are less exposed to religion and therefore becoming more irreligious in that sense.
Yeah, but they're not saying that we are not, I mean, because we were Muslims, we're not, they're not saying that we don't believe in Islam or that we're not Muslims, but their behavior is contrary to some of the religious aspects of that. I mean, let's take alcohol for instance. You know, I was amazed to be told that, you know, in this region, everybody drinks. And I thought, you know, people would drink. Yes, I know that. But to make a statement like everybody drinks was quite shocking.
Yeah, it's quite far-fetched. I mean, even you can study quite a few Muslim countries and you will realize that these practices are kind of, there's some normality to them. There is people who are engaged in this type of behaviors. But once again, my point is that is because of the absence of any clear-cut societal influence which prohibits these things. Otherwise, I mean, people want to be accessing these materials in the first place. Substances like alcohol, whether it is drugs, whether it is movies, you know, whatever it is. Obviously, Islam has a position on a lot of these things here. But there are people who are behaving in such a manner because, number one, it's legally acceptable in those societies. So if you go to many of the Arab world, many of the countries in Arab world, alcohol is legally, you know, sold.
Sure.
And many other types of influences which come outside from the West. So, you know, movies which are rated, you know, 15, 12, 18, may have content which is contrary to the teachings of Islam. These are widely promoted. So that's all people see. That's all they want in the end then. And the government doesn't enforce anything else which is contrary to, you know, what these movies are propagating.
Sure.
And therefore, there will be a religious void because they're not really getting anything from you know, the media or the institutions like education and you know, judiciary in terms of enforcing the Islamic laws, etc.
I think Majid has mentioned something very important, that religion is not really there. One of the things that I've noticed, that schools in that region, and I'm talking about good schools that people would want to send their children, are very secular.
Yes.
So I was quite surprised that I visited a school and it was time for prayers, and I said, you know, just show me where to pray. Then I suddenly realized that I didn't hear the azan. They said, well, we don't have that because we're not a religious school. And I said, but we're living in perceived Islamic state. Perceived or not, the fact is that we are living in a Muslim country. So are we then saying that, as Majid said, religion has not been practiced, therefore people do not understand? But I'm saying that because of that, we are seeing void.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. You started with the question,
is there such a thing as bad religion? And Majid made the point that actually the dissemination of religious knowledge has taken quite a severe hit across the Muslim world. And it's not the norm for especially people from privileged backgrounds or decently well-off backgrounds to make Islamic studies or the study of the deen a primary focus of their studies. Rather, they will take the secular route of education. So I don't know why, firstly, that is a surprise. But secondly, it flips the question of the title on its head. And what it does is it means that rather than contemplating whether the idea of bad religion or extremist interpretations leads to secularization of people, it's actually the other way around. That you've got a complete permeation or complete society that has been aggressively attacked by secularism. And that is probably, almost definitely, that leads to these sort of extremist interpretations in sort of a response or a retaliation or as a defensive mechanism. The truth of the entire scenario is inherent somewhere in between the two, which is those, it's building on Majid's point, which is those who lack the depth of understanding of what is essentially supposed to be more than just a theological discourse, it is supposed to be a way of life. Those who lack the true understanding of it are easily susceptible to ideas which are foreign and which seem to be, at least materialistically, dominant in the world. So the West being the dominant hemisphere and its values being those of aggressive secularism. So people aspire to those and they compare and contrast those with the lot of those we see as taking extremist interpretations or those who are, you know, promoted as the extreme fringe of Islam. And when they compare the two, they find that they personally want to be inclined towards the Western secular model than the other one. The problem within that is obviously that firstly it comes from a deficiency of their own knowledge, and secondly it creates a false sort of system where you've only got these two choices. The truth is that the millions upon millions across the world do understand Islam, do want to work to see Islam truly established in the world, but those either by design, because you don't want to give the idea too much propagation in the media and make it popular, or by the fact that they do not create as many noteworthy events. They're not carrying out suicide bombings and they're not dominating world economies. They seem to be conspicuous by their absence, as it were. But yes, a country like Pakistan does have a vast attack, a very sophisticated and detailed attack of values which are alien to its core. You've just been to Pakistan. I went to Pakistan a few years ago. I lived there when I was a child for about 5 or 6 years. I can compare. You see US aid posters all over. US aid is a declared arm of American foreign policy. Not a secret mission going on, not some sort of a covert operation. Open, declared posters, US aid, funding media companies in Pakistan, funding schools, funding etc. of this nature. When you allow this to happen, is it any surprise? Why is it that we wonder that the values of those who are spending the money and the time and the effort are being instilled in the people upon whom they are working?
It's very strange that you should say that. I was quite surprised to read in the newspaper, it said in a little corner that USA aid, if you find anyone who is abusing this in any of the projects, please report to the fraud department. I was quite surprised that that was actually in an international newspaper. But yes, but that still doesn't explain the point that in Muslim countries, you're saying there's a heavy onslaught of secular values, okay? I understand that.
And not enough of a counterbalance with true Islamic education and establishment of Islam as a living entity.
Yes, but
so you can see the living, breathing thing to compare. If your only comparison is between ISIS and America, you're going to make some false choices.
Yeah, I understand. But the fact is that we do have a choice, don't we? but we are not able to make that choice. Why do we not, for instance, in our schools have azan? Why don't we teach our children that our curriculum will be built around the prayer times? We don't have
as,
that.
As token as the gesture may be, because these are token gestures.
Yes, but they
as token
they
as it may be, you are right. But for example, let's pick one of those two issues. The syllabus thing. 7-8 years ago, towards the end of Musharraf's time, IMF restructured some of Pakistan's debt, and we're going to make another installment of a loan. And I couldn't understand it at the time, but I can now. It made no sense why an international economic and monetary body placed these conditions and caveats for the loan to be approved, one of which was the removal from Islamiyat, as religious education is generally known in schools there, the removal from the textbooks of ayat of the Quran referring to jihad and ayat of the Quran which are seen, which are critical of Bani Israel for their conduct, which are seen as anti-Semitic. These were preconditions of Pakistan being given that installment of a loan. So these things aren't happening by accident. That's why I said it's a very generic term, because you can't break it down into its multiple facets. But it's very clear cut that there is an aggressive attack of secularization simply because Pakistan, with its nuclear armory and with its very strong military, and with the fact that people still do hold very strong allegiance to Islam even without understanding it. So, you know, poll after poll will suggest upwards of 80% of people wanting Sharia law without fully understanding the scope of what they are talking about. If more people knew, more people would desire it. So with all of those things there, it is vastly important geostrategically that Pakistan does not become a hub of an Islamic entity. And for those who would rather not see that happen, they are spending a lot of time and a lot of money and a lot of effort, and they have gone to war in that region, and they're using drone attacks in your country, all for making sure what they call trying to win the hearts and minds. And that is not an innocent or a sincere gesture. It is, these people should toe the line that we want them to toe. That's always been the attempt or the object of any imperialistic maneuver, and American imperialism right now wants exactly that.
Adnan talks about Pakistan, and of course this is something very, very close to our hearts, but do you feel that there is an extreme religion which is creating extremism? Bad, and I know I keep saying bad religion, and when I talk about bad religion, I think about Dawkins, because he does bad religion all the time.
Yep.
So will one extreme produce another extreme behavior? You know, people who become atheist, for me, is an extreme behavior. But that, and I'm saying, because there's no religion as such, or understanding of religion. But do you think that's also happening in a country like UK, in the Western world?
Yeah, so let's take UK as an example. I was just about to go towards that. Mm-hmm. Extreme religion, the only type of people who use this type of language are politicians.
Okay.
And they're there to create debate on these loaded terms in order for them to achieve specific objectives. So they've set up a scene now in Britain where to talk about certain things is considered extreme. To say homosexuality is a sin, that is considered too extreme. It's too far down the line. What they do then is develop a set of acceptable Islamic ideas and a set of ideas which are originally from Islam but not suitable in this modern world. So think about a young Muslim growing up, male, female, young guy and girl. They're seeing all the news, they're seeing all the hype, they're seeing extensive coverage of people being picked up by police in morning raids because they've come back from Syria, or they're planning to go into Syria to help, or wherever that may be. And it's building an entire picture, building an entire narrative that, look, you don't want to do what these guys do. Okay, religion, you know, this is why David Cameron did his Eid message, okay, inside the Parliament House. Okay, you know, calling, inviting Muslim people down, look, I've got nothing against Islam, I've got nothing against you guys, Islam is a beautiful and peaceful religion. You know, so let's celebrate, you know, the end of fasting, let's celebrate the Hajj, etc. So there's deliberately, you know, maneuvers made by the government to show that, look, this is acceptable Islam, but everything else is unacceptable. Challenging foreign policy is unacceptable. If you don't wear a poppy, that's unacceptable. If you don't wear a British hijab to...
With a poppy.
With a poppy on as well, that's unacceptable.
Let's take this call, Majid. Assalamualaikum.
Walaikum assalam.
Assalamualaikum, yes.
Walaikum assalam. Sabla Jabbar from Bradford speaking.
Assalamualaikum
to your guests.
Gigi.
The point I want to make is, if we look at the life of the Prophet ﷺ, and one of the instances that happened in Medina when alcohol was prohibited, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verses banning alcohol completely, you saw these streets of... the streets of Medina, people coming out and getting rid of the alcohol. So, and even to the extent where people just drank it, they puked out, they made themselves sick, so they removed it from their bodies. We saw a similar law. Hello?
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 Hello? Yes,
yeah.
we can hear you, sir. We can hear you.
So we saw a similar law being, similar prohibition in America in the 1920s. With the prohibition law, it was known, and it was same that, you know, we need to, the law was banning alcohol. But we saw the opposite effect, where alcohol was consumed more, and you had these dens and gambling dens, and more crime took place because of this prohibition law, and people did not abide by this law. So the difference in that is because I believe that because in Medina, the Muslims, they knew who is the legislator, who is the one to give legislation, who is the one to give us halal and haram, and they acted upon that.
Sure.
And also you have the law as well, you know, the state of Medina to enforce the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in America, because men decide the laws, so people... did not accept the law of other people. Why should I accept the law of another human being to tell me what is right and wrong? So there's a moral compass. Who decides the moral compass for us in a society? Is it man or is it Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
Right. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Jazakallah khair for your call. Important. Yeah. Who decides the moral compass?
The moral compass, going back, this is in this country, in this society now, it's the government which is deciding what is the moral compass of Muslims, what is acceptable, what is not acceptable. The net effect, we're talking about, are people moving more towards Islam, or are the youth in general distancing themselves from Islam? If they see these scenes and they've got no way of viewing these events from a particular framework, and you know, dissecting what's happening in front of them and really providing a counter narrative, a counter view to this, then obviously they'll accept the status quo and they will go with the flow. And they will say, okay, what we'll do is, to be honest, I don't think it's feasible to have a beard, or it's feasible for me to wear a hijab or a jilbab or even a niqab. So just in Manchester, just today, we had this report about who got attacked in Piccadilly. There's been another report where a sister's niqab was taken off, I think it was in Glasgow, forced off. So people in this climate now are thinking, okay, what should we do? What should we not do there then? And that's important for us to kind of appreciate. These are the problems that Muslims are going through as a community, but how do we address these? How do we produce that counter-narrative?
Yeah.
And is it by distancing ourselves away from Islam that we're going to solve these issues, or by adhering more towards Islam and practicing the Islamic stances? You know, the Quran is full of verses of the Quran which say stand up against injustice. So how do we go about doing that in the British terrain?
Okay, let's take the call. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Assalamu alaikum, Jahangir Bhai.
Wa alaikum assalam. How are you?
Are you well, sir?
I am, thank you.
Jahangir Bhai, we're looking at religion, good religion, bad religion, but we're really interested in is there some kind of extreme religion which is moving people towards atheism, or, you know, becoming devoid of any religion? What do you think, sir?
Well, I think, generally speaking, the nature of the government produces the values of the people. And, I usually put it this way. If you have a football team and the manager believes in playing in an attacking style, the team will play in that style. If you have secularism and a secular society, then you will produce a secular culture and a secular secular way of life. And, you know, religion can have its place in that society, but sooner or later the forces of secularism, and, you know, they can go extreme as well. You know, we've seen extreme secularism in the Soviet Union during the 20th century in most parts of Western Europe, and they're equally as destructive, in fact, more so than religious societies have been. So I think it's a question of really what values are you know, put into place by the government. So if you look at Muslim societies, Pakistan, for example, it's often quoted as an Islamic republic, but it's a secular state, and the society that we see there is secularizing. We've seen it in Iraq and Syria. These were Ba'athist regimes. Iraq was a very secular society, and you know, Syria also. And what we see is that eventually, you know, these societies also produce injustice. And for Muslims, we are given numerous examples and references to societies that have abandoned the way of Allah. The way Western philosophy works and understanding is, it's a bit like Darwin's theory. They have a Darwin's theory for science. They also have one for society. There's a belief that, you know, society evolves from a, if you like, a one stage to another, but always for the good. That's not always the case. The Quran tells us otherwise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that actually it works in a different way. Societies progress, and when they deviate from the Creator's laws, the Creator himself brings about the conditions for those societies to be destroyed, and we find numerous examples in the Quran of this. And even if we were to look around us now, you know, look at the state of Iraq today. Look at what happened to Bosnia when the state broke up. We see that the Muslims there were very, very secular. There was 60% intermarriage rate between Serbs and Muslims. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings the societies back towards the Creator, because ultimately, you know, the Creator knows best, and he determines what's in the best interest for mankind. And there's different schools of thought amongst Muslims at the moment. Some believe that you can have a secular state and still have Islam. Others believe that, you know, to create an Islamic culture, Islamic values and Islamic civilization, you have to have an Islamic state, and the state, if you like, promoting those values.
Jahangir Bhai, as always, it's an honor and pleasure to have you, and I think you have raised some very important points. I hope that we have the time to discuss them all. Jazakallah khair for your time.
Jazakallah khair.
Thank you. We're just going to take a short break. Please don't go away. Join me back within the next 2 minutes. Jazakallah khair. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to Community Platform. Subject matter is, of course, is extreme religion, bad religion, leading Muslims to abandon religion altogether, or certainly to become, or to have create a void. What do you think? The number is on the screen. Give us a call and tell us what you think. Adnan, Jahangir Bhai, just before break, talked about how religion was suppressed when he talked about Bosnia, for instance. But religion then came back with vengeance. We saw what happened in Eastern Europe. We're seeing what's happening. And that's a frightening thought, that if you suppress something, it will come back with a vengeance. Are we seeing a clash of civilization and Huntington professed a long time ago?
Huntington didn't just profess this. Huntington has another very famous quote, which was that the, words to the nearest effect of, that the superiority over the world, or the hegemony that the West holds, is not built upon superior technological or intellectual advances, but at being superior in violence. And we in the West often tend to forget this, mm-hmm. but those who to whom we do this do not forget this. You can trace almost every single group across the Muslim world who are labeled as extremists in varying degrees, or terrorists, or, you know, etc., etc., all the other notorious titles that have been given to such entities. You can trace them all back to being a reaction of this kind of a movement, of this kind of, you know, unwanted sort of violence or imperialism or control of their resources, control of their political processes, meddling in their affairs, etc., etc. So it's not something that we need to sit here and theorize about. We can see it playing out in reality, where you get a country like America going into Iraq and killing 1 million people, or, you know, upwards of 100,000, even at the lowest estimates. And in so doing, part of the rationale that was presented was Al-Qaeda are finding safe haven here, extremists, you know, are spreading their wings from here, the axis of evil, the now infamous speech from George Bush. And what has happened is, you know, if we take things on a linear sort of progression, now in that same region, you have a group or an entity who Al-Qaeda refer to as, these guys are extremists. Mm-hmm. These guys are too far. That's the reaction that is natural. It produces you know, absurd results. It produces results you cannot gauge. But the point that Jahangir made, which was probably the main focal issue that you should focus on, is that we speak of these countries and these places as Muslim societies, and that is true, in that the populations are majority Muslim, and certain Muslim or Islamic values still continue to be foundational in people's lives. But the systems that control these societies, the governments, the economic systems, the militaries, etc., are deeply secular and secularizing. Mm. So to have some sort of a product of this secularization on a state level is natural. It's actually a wonder and a surprise, given the efforts. Well, it's not a surprise because it's the hikmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it's on a simplistic level, when you think about it, it's quite perplexing why they have failed in their secularization attempts of a country like Pakistan, where you will get ridiculous things, not religiously correct, but ridiculous things such as the two Christians being burnt. Mm. Yes. Now what you can leave aside the fact that this is obviously a crime and people should not be able to take the law in their own hands, etc., etc., even if a crime was committed. But what you can gauge from this is, using the idea of Islam, you can still inflame people's emotions if you do it insincerely, or if it is in a sincere manner. If you stand out as somebody who deliberately maligns or insults those sentiments which are purely Islamic, people, even ill-educated people, people who are prepared to go to such extremes, people who are prepared to commit crimes, even they will feel an extreme mm-hmm. strength of that emotion, which leads to these sort of things.
That's quite dangerous, isn't it? When you think about it, that's very dangerous. And this is the point I think maybe has been amiss, that if you don't have understanding of the faith, and as you both alluded to that, then it will lead to that kind of extremism. As Adnan said, where two Christians were burnt alive, it would lead to that kind of extremism. If not only that you're giving up your religion, you're almost behaving in a very irreligious manner.
Yeah, and it plays perfectly into the hands of politicians who say, look, there we go, Islam can never work, religion can never work. This is what religion causes inside our societies: friction, tension. Mm-hmm. And therefore secularism, which puts all religions on par, mm-hmm. and one law to govern everybody, which is irreligious, that's the best way forward. Mm-hmm. But still, as Adnan mentioned, you know, this is still, and as Jahangir Bhai mentioned as well, secularism is very self-destructive. I mean, just to put things into context, You know, in Britain, we were talking about the question earlier on about, you know, how does this affect young people in Britain, and does it make them more distant from Islam when they hear of, you know, bad religion, extreme religion? If you look at the statistics, you know, like I said, the governments like to paint a picture that Muslims are at the forefront of terrorism and terrorist activity. I mean, according to the Europol, they published an annual report, what is called the EU Terrorism Situation and Trend Report, and they found that an overwhelming 99.6% of terrorist attacks in Europe were by non-Muslim groups.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, 84.8% of attacks were from separatist groups completely unrelated to Islam, and leftist groups and separatist groups. These are the people, this is the majority, this is in the high 90s of people who are committing terrorist activity, but who gets to blame? Who's in the center of the attention? And there's a certain reason for that there then. And that's why people tend to then maybe distance themselves away from any type of outward religiousness, and, you know, maybe inwardly as well, they start doubting, okay, if this is what Islam is, this is what we see.
It's politically expedient. Majid's onto a fantastic thing there. If you want to talk about bad religion, let's take the two situations. Let's take Islam, let's take this secularism, the two things that you've placed as part of the topic. And let's look at them both as, you know, ideas by which to live life. So let's not call them religions, because that's quite a narrow term, because Islam in itself doesn't portray itself as a religion. Let's look at them as ideas by which to live life or run societies. Now, let's look at our track record. Is it bad religion when secular ideals and secular values lead to, what I already said, the murder, the almost genocide of people in Iraq? Is it secularism which is to blame? And it is, if we're going to have that comparison, it is definitely to blame for these things. Is it secularism which the world's biggest secular state, India, claims, you know, to be a follower of, and it has Kashmir, the most militarized zone on the planet, 700,000 of Indian army in a small valley? Is it secularism in a place, although they might argue that it's not, but is it secularism in a place like Israel when they bomb Palestinians? Is it secularism when America has an imperialistic control over the vast majority of the globe, where they've had, I think, less than 20 years of their 240-odd year history, less than 20 years, something like 17 years, where they have not been at war? So if you want to compare bad religion, bad secularism is actual secularism. The truth is that a place like Pakistan, right now, it is not a religious place on a government level. You can look at it. Is democracy a part of Islam where man is given the power to legislate? No, it isn't. Pakistan is a secular country. Is the economy in an Islamic state built upon and run by interest-based banking, interest-based foreign loans? No, it isn't. Pakistan is a secular state. Is a place like Pakistan, where you already, you know, alluded to those things, such as alcohol, etc., and things worse than this, which are freely available, is that an Islamic value? No, it isn't. Pakistan is a secular place. Pakistan, on a governmental level, is being organized for decades now in a secular strand. Even people who have passed laws which looked so-called secular, people like Zulfikar Ali Bhutto, banning alcohol, were themselves well-renowned secular people. He used to say all the time, it was a populist slogan, people still repeat it to this day in the PPP, our religion is Islam, our economy is socialism, and our politics is democracy.
Let's take this call, Adnan. Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Ilyas.
Welcome, Salam.
Are you well, sir?
I'm well, thank you.
Dr. Ilyas, I know that you've done a lot of work on this topic. Do you think that aggressive religion or bad religion is causing a lot of Muslims to become atheist, or certainly have become devoid of any faith?
I think, yes. There is an element of, there is a drift of Muslims, born Muslims actually drifting away from practicing Islam. And of course, there is also sort of a amount of drift from convert Muslims actually leaving Islam. So yes, I mean, there are these elements of certain types of Islam and acts done in the name of Islam by various organizations, various groups that are actually causing a lot of discontent among the Muslim populace, not just, of course, in the Muslim world, but also in Europe as well. I mean, we've seen sort of organizations like the Council of Ex-Muslims in Britain, and they've got various offshoots in Europe and North America. So, you know, there certainly is, and you have to recognize as Muslims that there is this drift of Muslims, you know, really being self-critical and considering their faith.
Okay. It almost seems as if... Sorry, Adnan, you wanted to say something?
It may be maybe not a reflection of reality, but is it not fair to say that those who see these, what, you know, the vast majority of the Muslim Ummah across the globe would accept as, you know, absurd or far-fetched interpretations of Islamic texts, and therefore, you know, the violence that stems from them, those who are not able to see that this is not Islamic, is that, is the fault not with them? And secondly, sorry, one little thing you said at the end, is it not very clear that there is an agenda at play? I you know, it might be for my ignorance, but I have never heard of an council of ex-Hindus or council of ex-Jews. Why is there a council of ex-Muslims? They're atheists. Join the rest of the atheist band. Why do they hold a special status? Why is it that they need to be promoted and propagated and given media space and oxygen? Why is it that it's only those people who've left Islam who are given that you know, status in the West?
Yeah, I mean, your guest makes a valid point. I mean, ex-Muslims have certainly come out since 9/11. I mean, one of the pivotal moments was then was 9/11. I mean, this is not to argue or suggest that that there were Muslims who didn't consider their faith or were left or were left religious prior to this. But certainly, it is important to recognise that Muslims are considering their faith. We've seen reports in Pakistan. We've seen reports, I mean, my own work in the research that we've done here, that there are Muslims, young Muslims are considering their faith. You know, let's not be ignorant of the fact that, you know, as much as 9/11 and 7/7 brought Muslims back to their faith, equally, and of course we don't often hear about these minorities, but there are people who are critical of their faith. So I think we have to accept that there are both elements happening, and it would be ignorant to reject both elements.
Dr. Ilyas, thank you so much for your time. We're very grateful. Jazakallah
khair. No problem.
Assalamu alaikum.
I think at the same time, it can be argued that, as the doctor said there, that you've got to look at both sides. I mean, to be honest, atheism is just not even a handful of people in Pakistan who are moving towards this trend. Mm. And these are people who, you know, live lavish lifestyles. They've got nothing else better to do apart from make sajda to the West. Mm. And these are the people like your Bilawal Bhuttos, and these are people who are your Hassan Nawazes.
I hope he's not listening to this.
No, he should be. They need to hear what people think of these people, of them. These are the class of elite people we're talking about here. Mm-hmm. We're not talking about the arm person in Pakistan who's all of a sudden becoming an atheist, because opinion poll after opinion poll gives us a different picture. So it's not all grim and dim. We look at the Gallup opinion polls done successively over the last years. Each one, time from time again, it mentions that people in their personal lives are practicing Islam. People visit the masjid. They even opinion polls asking people... But the programming that they see on television stations, are they happy with this? Is it Islamic? Should there be more Islamic? Is the Muharram and Ramadan programming significantly Islamic? Are they happy with this? You know, what do they think about Sharia in Pakistan? Mm-hmm. What do they think about people who commit crimes? How should they be punished? Should they be punished by the law that exists, or should we apply Islamic law? And the vast majority of people in Pakistan have voted for Islamic law.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So therefore, I think the band of people that we have, these secularists, and who've then gone off onto the next trend, which is adopting atheism as a lifestyle choice.
It's almost fashionable. I mean, I was quite surprised to find young people, and you know, I try to go, you know, gauge with them to say, well, tell me what you think atheism actually means. I don't think I ever got a response what atheism means, but what I did get was they were fed up of religion.
But their failure to understand or explain or elucidate Islam means that they don't feel comfortable with it. Now, whose failing is that? Well, firstly, the duty will fall on, you know, the parents who felt it was more important for these people to become physicists and biologists, etc., than to understand Islam. Not that the two are a dichotomy. But primarily, it comes back to what we've said, you know, time and time again. The state is responsible for nurturing the not just the youth, but the entire society. Societies are run by one of two, or, you know, in the Islamic system, by both of these, the presence of both of these spheres, mm-hmm. as it were. One is the beautiful, comprehensive nature of Islam, the Sharia, in being able to provide justice, provide punishment to those who, you know, etc. But the other one is probably the more important aspect, and that is the spiritual domain, mm-hmm. which is established by having an Islamic society, where you don't commit crime not just because the punishment will be severe, mm-hmm. but also because your Creator is watching. Mm-hmm. And a lot of that is down to, you know, a state-organized system. For example, in the vast majority of mm-hmm. things which are to do with worship, mm-hmm. the state does not interfere. However, there is a prescribed punishment mm-hmm. for missing Salah without reason. Mm-hmm. Now, you may mm-hmm. weigh this up and think, yeah. why are they trying to force you to go to heaven? Well, it'd be a good thing if they did. But no, the idea is that you cannot allow open disobedience to Islam in the society in this manner. And that is something that Pakistan or any other government cannot say they've come anywhere close to doing.
We'll come back to that. Sorry, Adnan, to cut you. We've got a caller. I think it's Sister Khushi from Preston. Assalamu alaikum, Sister.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Sister, I'm going to say that you've got 30 seconds. We're at that end of that program, unfortunately. So you have a question. Well, a very quick question, Sister.
Yeah, I don't have a question. I'm just listening to you guys. And I think you said bad religions and good religions. I believe there are no bad religions in the world. Now we come to Islam. Islam is a beautiful religion. It's about peace, harmony, unity, respect, manners, family values. But why people are not getting good name for Muslims? Because we are not practicing Islam.
Sure.
The things are happening in Pakistan, especially in Pakistan. They are some of the things. Criminal things happening are so disgusting that nobody wants to even talk about them. For example, trafficking, child abuse, all these issues, nobody wants to take part and talk about them because they think it's too disgusting. But somebody has to come forward and take a step. As a community, what are we doing about it? We will hear the news, switch the TV off, go to sleep, start the new day.
True. And you certainly are doing a lot of good work. I know that in your area. Jazakallah khair, sister. Hope to see you soon. Assalamu alaikum. Guys, it's that time when I say, let's conclude. I know that we can't change the world. We cannot tell people. But what's the solution in 30 seconds?
Islam is not just a religion of, as we like to say, in this new secularized order, peace, harmony, etc., etc. All of those things are true. Islam is the true religion of assessing reality and establishing justice. And failing to do this is the actual failure of all governments across the Muslim world, and you will find every single secular government as well. The truth is that it is not bad religion, or extreme interpretations of religion which are leading people to secularization. It is an organized campaign on a government level and the people's own lack of knowledge. But the opposite is definitely true, that every single strand of violent extremist interpretation that comes out of religious sort of doctrine is inspired by the violence that comes in reality from secular places such as Britain, such as America, such as the West in general. They are the cause of the extremists existing. Secular states existed for the past 200 years. Terrorism didn't.
Good point. I'm going to end at that. Good point. Majid.
It's not as dim. I mean, one of the opinion polls I've got in front of me over here in 2011, majority of Pakistanis wanted to identify themselves as Muslim first, even before calling themselves Pakistani. Mm. So from an identity point of view, they're more likened to be, you know, synonymous with the Islamic belief rather than their geographic location. So this is a good sign here. Within Pakistan itself, I'll finish off with the points of the last caller mentioned, all the things that she mentioned, all the ills. You know, these ills are as a result of the absence of a cohesive Islamic leadership and Islamic system which enforces the correct Islamic laws, establishes the rule of law, and puts forward strict punishments for those who, you know, pass the law, bypass the law and commit crimes. And the establishment of this type of entity would lead to a more constructive, a more productive society. So religion isn't necessarily
gonna have to stop you there,
a bad
Majid.
Thing, it's a force
Thank
for
you so
good
much.
For the film.
Jazakallah khair for watching. There's no simple solution, but one thing is absolutely, absolutely clear, that how we bring up our families, how we bring up our children, what kind of tarbiyah do we offer them? I think that is extremely important, certainly at an individual level, and certainly as a woman I can say that the role of a mother is extremely important in how we bring up our children, how we produce that personality, and hopefully that will go off to be, at least would be some of the solution. I'm very grateful to you, Adnan, thank you. Thank you as always, to the point. Majid, thank you so much.
Welcome.
And to you for allowing us to come into your homes. See you next week. Until then, please look after yourself and your neighbor, whoever they may be. Assalamu alaikum.